Hello, everyone. Great day to you. And welcome to another episode of LEADJITSU Rise in the Dojo. This is the show that helps leaders gain inspiration and insight so that they can elevate their influence and impact. We have an incredible show for you today. We've also planned to have a little bit of fun in this whole thing. So just roll with us as we get ready to rise. Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of LEADJITSU Rise in the Dojo. Super excited to be here with you today. We're going to have a conversation today about authentic relationships conversations, and we're going to learn a little bit about the Graticube. So I want to say good morning to everyone. So good morning, Ms. Roz Jones. How are you this morning?
I am fabulous. No technical difficulties, honey. So I'm ready.
good. We are so glad to have you here. Good morning or good evening to you, Marae. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic as well. Good morning to you on the other side of the world.
Awesome. And we are so excited and incredibly really honored to have our guest here with us, our special guest here today. So I'm going to just do a short introduction of Mr. Sam Sokol, who is just magical at integrating tech with gamification. He has taken his experience and all of his skills and combined that together. He's now an inventor, and he is the creator of Graticube, a little game with a big heart. So Sam, I'm really excited to have you. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you.
Awesome. So we're going to dive in and get started. But before we go and we do our breathing for today, we like to do our breathing before we enter the dojo. So before we do that today, I have just one question that I would like for you to answer for us. Can you tell us one thing that Graticube can teach humanity?
It's a great question. I think the best thing we can do for each other is listen. So often we may want to jump in with an opinion or an advice or whatever, but when we choose to listen and hold space for others, I think that's the gift of Graticube. Choosing to open the box and play the game is a choice to drop in with others and make that journey from head to heart. And so in the heart space, we can really be, we can hold that space for others to be who they are.
I love that. So that's perfect. So that's going to just a peek into what we're going to get into today. So before we get started, let's go into our mastery breathing. So we like to do our deep breathing before we enter the dojo. And one of the reasons is because our breathing is really connected to our success. It's really connected to our life force. And so just a little quick fact about breathing. Did you know that deep breathing before you go to bed at night can help you sleep better? Helps relax the mind, helps relax the body. So if you are someone who struggles with sleeping at night, you might try a little bit of deep breathing before you go. So I'd like us to do two rounds of deep breathing. You can leave your eyes open or closed. You're gonna breathe in for four and out for four, in through the nose and out through the nose. I'll do it with you. We'll do two rounds of that, and then we will prepare to enter the dojo. So you can get started when you're ready. Two rounds of breathing. In for four. And out for four. In for four. And out for four. All right. I feel ready. I hope you're ready. Let's get ready to step into the dojo. All right. So really excited about our conversation today, and we're going to dive right in. So I want to start first, Sam. I'm going to ask you about authentic relationships. What does that even mean to you? Because I think sometimes it means different things to different people.
Yeah, a great question about authenticity. I mean, authenticity, integrity, being true to oneself, thinking about martial arts and sort of this practice of going inside first, or to their own self be true. If you start from that place, I think authenticity starts from within. And the willingness to present yourself and be who you are, to me, is authenticity. And having the courage to share that, to be vulnerable, to be open, is the next step, right? So once you have that sense of self, which changes over time, it's not to say your sense of self today is going to be the sense of self you have in 20 years, but it's to bring forward that authentic sense of who you are into everything that you do and into your work. If there's something you feel called to do, I think of integrity in that way. Integrity is this sort of inner wisdom. We all feel a sense of something, right? If you were to steal something, like when I was a kid, I stole something. I took something off the shelf. I took it home. My mom was upset at me. And it was that I knew it. I knew something was wrong, right? So I had that sense even before maybe I was given a full moral code that it didn't feel right. And so there's these moments of saying, does it feel right? Does it feel, bad in your body? Using that as a barometer to say, who am I? What am I? And how do I bring what's true to me into the world? I think that's a question of authenticity. So authentically relating with others is the invitation and permission for us to do that together.
I love that. So before I come to you, Roz, I'm going to get you and Marie to respond to that. But I want to say good morning. Mom's out there. Mom says, good morning. The new show is so exciting. Ready to step into the dojo with a tall, cool cantaloupe smoothie on the side. I will tell you, there is nobody that tops my mom's drinks. Whenever she's on the show, her drinks are the best. So good morning, Mom. Sis is out there. Good morning, Regina in Texas. Looking forward to her experience of stepping in the dojo. Dojo stays in the dojo, hashtag members only. And then we have Christopher out there. Hi, Christopher. Extraordinary morning and Thursday to everyone. He also says, if you're watching this, it means you want to win. Yes, because that's what we do. And we also have GR Houston Jack out there. Good morning. Good morning to you. Thanks so much for tuning in. So, Roz and Marie, what do you think about that authentic relationships and how Sam described that? And I just add in this little piece, why does it feel so weird and clunky all the time? And Marie, we'll come to you first.
It is very interesting because, we sometimes don't really know who we are. So it's very difficult to actually understand what authenticity is, and it can be a blockage. So for me, yes, it's about, really coming as you are, but do you know yourself? That's the thing. So, and that's the big question when we talk about authenticity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree, Marie. That's a good point, Roz. We may not know who we are, right? So how do we authentically show up when we haven't done that work of knowing who we are?
Yeah, we can't show up as us because we're so busy working and helping everybody else. So the inner work that we're supposed to do can't get done because we're spending 12 hours on everybody else. And then by the time it's time for us to get to our 12 hours, then we're working and then taking care of family and home. So where is the part for us to, as he said, go inside of us and then, work on that inner wisdom. So if we don't work on us first, take care of our foundation, then no, we can't be authentic. We can't do what we're supposed to do because we are, and I'm just speaking as a woman, we're so busy nurturing and taking care of everybody else. We are always on the back burner. Mm-hmm. Our needs are always on the back burner. So can somebody really figure out who we are or know us, our integrity or our character? No, because we have not done what we're supposed to do for people to be able to see that piece that we're talking about today.
Mm-hmm. No, I love that. And that piece, it feels like a theme here that we're all speaking to, knowing who we are and mm-hmm. showing up as who we are. The one counter I always share in that respect, and I love to hear your thoughts on this, Sam, is I always say to people, be your authentic self, unless you're authentically awful. And if you are, then be somebody else. Don't be that awful person that you are. And that often comes from really not knowing who you are still. Mm-hmm. But still, sometimes you've developed these habits that are not good, right? They're mm-hmm. not kind. They're not genuine. They're not compassionate. And if that's who you are, don't be that person. Like, I don't want to be in relationship with that person. And so I don't know, Sam, how would you respond to that?
Well, I think it's well said, because it's ultimately a choice, right? How I choose to show up is a choice. I mean, I think of sort of, you know, namaste, right? The essence of namaste is the light in me honors the light in you. And the darkness in me honors the darkness in you. We are all of those things. We are the light. We are the dark. And we get to choose which of those things we bring out in our behaviors. So when you say a habit, like if you're habitually, you know, choosing behaviors that maybe are mean or mean-spirited, that's a choice. You could choose to say that. So when I think of a relationship I'm having a challenge with, I like to call out the behavior as a third party to the relationship that we have. In other words, the light in me honors the light in you is the relationship we have. And you may be choosing behaviors that don't support the relationship that I want or that you want. So I can say, well, you know, I really love you. And this behavior is not one that I want to see in our relationship. Mm.
Uh-huh. That's really good. Roz?
I was just thinking about that. Your behavior does... I'm going to be good. I could go a whole lot of ways with this, honey. your behavior is counteractive to my values. It's counteractive. So I don't have to allow you in my space. So I'm going to evict you based on your behaviors. Thank you so much. That's what I want. I'm going to evict you.
It's so difficult to do, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Raven's out there. Raven says, love the glasses. And then Mom said, I agree, Chris, watching this show because we want to win. But it's true. And so as we think about those behaviors, so let's talk a little bit about that, because I also sometimes think that we don't see our behaviors as sort of blocking that inner authentic great person that we are, right? We don't see the behaviors what are some of those behaviors that cause us to show up and sort of maybe block those deeper relationships that you want to? And I'll start with one. There's a gentleman who I spend some time on Clubhouse some mornings, and Dave Meltzer, for all of those of you out there who know Dave Meltzer, he was the CEO of the sporting agency that Jerry Maguire was sort of filmed after or inspired by. And so he always says, be more interested than interesting, right? Mm-hmm. And so we have a tendency to show up and want to talk all about us, and we want to start. And the moment the conversation starts, we start talking and we don't stop. And so we're very interested in having everyone else hear us and know about us. Sam, does that block our ability to have those deeper connections?
I think it does. So can I tell you just a brief story?
Sure.
Okay. So I went to Burning Man in 2017, and at the end of over a week. Are you familiar with Burning Man? I mean, some people sort of don't know what Burning Man is.
I think some people may not, so you could explain it.
All right. So Burning Man is sort of a social experiment, is the way I see it. And it started out with just a few people, and it's grown to over 70,000. And they go to the desert for a week and participate in music and celebration of art and all sorts of things. They're in a temporary city called Black Rock City in the Nevada desert. Okay. Now, this is a crazy celebration because you pack it in, pack it out. The only thing that's available there are bathrooms, basically. And then everyone brings whatever they want to share with others for that event. So you have people from all over the world, all different walks of life. Some people have a lot of money, some people have very little money, but everybody's going there to engage in this kind of experiment. Can we live by 10 principles over a week? And what does that look like? And so when I've been several times in 2014, I've been 5 times to Burning Man. But this particular time driving home, I felt like I hadn't connected with some of these very interesting people from all over the world as well as I wanted to. So back to the point of the question you asked, what are some of the things that get in the way? That's very much what I was asking on a long drive home. I had 24 hours of this drive home to think about that question. So as I thought about, well, how do I want to show up next time? What do I want to do differently? I thought maybe I could be a better listener. And in the radical celebration of humanity that this is, these principles are like radical inclusion, radical self-reliance, so and radical participation. So I thought, okay, well, if I was going to listen radically, what would that look like? So I chose to be silent for a week the next year. So I had this little card in my pocket, right? So if I connected with somebody and they're like, why is this guy not talking? I was a spectacle, right? I didn't wear it around my neck or anything, but I had it in my pocket. It was a little card. And it said, since I learned to speak, I haven't stopped. So for this week, I'm choosing to be silent. And if there's something you might want to share, I promise I won't interrupt. So I think your point, it's a commitment to listen a little bit more. To be interested is to listen, right? And you can go too far, I think. You could be so, you know, interested that you're just listening, you kind of disappear. And I felt that sometimes so there's a balance. It's not just to say, only be interested or only be interesting. But I really like that frame, Rhonda, that we choose to be interested. How do we choose to do that? Well, I could listen. I could even ask better questions. And so I had a question card for each day of the week. You know, what do you love? What do you fear? What inspires you? What surprises you? Those kinds of things. And then sometimes that was a really great conversation starter to be interested.
Wow, that's really powerful. So, Roz, do you think you could walk around for a week without speaking?
Yes, ma'am, I sure can.
I don't know if I can do it.
I often tell people, and my girlfriend is here with me, listen to this. I often say silence is a strategy.
Mm-hmm.
It's important, like you said, sometimes just to sit back and don't say anything and to watch people and to listen. And you'll be surprised how much you've missed because you've done all the talking or you've led the conversation or you've been the leader. A lot of times when I go to work, particularly in caregiving, sitting back and watching tells me a lot about my patient, tells me a lot about the family, tells me a lot about the facility where I am. When I just sit back, because even when I go to the parking lot, I sit back and watch the activity that's coming in and out so I know about my surrounding. Silence is a good strategy. It's really good because you can pick up a lot of things that people don't tell you that's going on internally with them.
I love that, Roz. That's so good. Mariah?
What I wanted to say is that it also depends on, you know, the cultural, environment as well. Because in some country, it's about you, speaking, being visible, and the more you talk, the more you're visible, the more you own the room, the more powerful you are. But in some, remote country, the more powerful is actually the one listening, saying really less. And so it really depends, on the dynamic. You need to really work on that to know exactly, how are you going to show up and really do your homework up front to really decide how you're going to show up in that particular environment. And that it can be very difficult, especially when you cross, different cultures.
Maria, I wonder if in those scenarios where you have leaders in different countries, and I think you're right, it's very cultural the way they communicate with each other. I couldn't agree more. Mm-hmm. If you think about those leaders, to me it seems that a form of leadership or a good form of leadership is listening. And so maybe the leader speaking from the perspective of being interested first in the people they serve, so that they've done a good job of listening, and that's the voice that they're carrying forward. They're carrying forward the voice after they've listened to the people that they're supposed to represent.
I love that idea, and I think that's really powerful. I want to say, get a couple of comments in here. So Jerry Houston says, yes, we get to choose. It is a choice to behave that way. And I will say this, JR, sometimes we don't recognize the choice that we're making because it's so habitual, right? We just do what we do because we've been doing it for so long and we don't realize how this habit shows up. Trina says, that's good. Hey, Trina, good morning. Welcome. And Raven says, I really like that idea of being silent for a week. I need to extend this to my family too. What's interesting as we're on this conversation, and we're going to eventually, you all hang in there with us because we're actually going to talk more about the Graticube game and as a way to help us with some of this relationship building and connection building. But I also wanted to mention the fact that we talk about listening. Listening is one of the greatest forms of caring that we can show. So as we did our cultural transformation work around the world, we helped people understand that it's in the listening that the caring happens. You know, we can do all day, we're human beings, we're used to being human doings, right? Doing all of this stuff. But being there for someone, quietly listening them is some of the best time that you can spend because it shows them you are important. You matter to me. I want to hear what you have to say. I value what you have to say. I don't have to agree with it. That's not the same thing, right? Valuing what you have to say is not the same thing as agreeing with what you're saying. But as a person, everyone wants to be heard and valued and cared for and respected. And one of the ways that we can do that is through listening. Yeah. So any thoughts on that before we sort of continue the conversation?
I wanted to come back to something Roz said just a bit ago about the strategy of listening and also values, values in a relationship. We're playing a little bit of a game with each other all the time, and hopefully we really like the rules of that game and that engagement. And so if you say one of our values is that we are kind and respectful and we listen to each other, then what a cool strategy. What a cool strategy to be a great listener in a relationship. And you say, you know, in this relationship and the relationships that really matter in my life, this is one of my values. Would you be willing to play by these rules? And you say, oh, cool, how do we win? Well, the strategy is we're great listeners to each other.
Wow. Ross? Oh, Marie?
So you basically have to set, it's like everything, you have to set the rule of engagement to allow this, you know, communication to be successful. Because if you know, you play by certain rules and the other person play by other rules, then yeah, it becomes a problem.
It does. I agree with that. And Trina says, listening also shows that you value that person's feelings, right? It's not just your feelings here. Mm-hmm. Listening really opens up to say, there are two of us here and we both matter. And let's bring that to the center. And that can be the place that we move forward from. Think about all of the discourse and the strife that we have in the world. What if we were just all able to listen to each other, respect each other, value each other, again, not agree, but respect each other as human beings and say, I hear what you're saying and thank you for sharing it. What a powerful place for us to show up from. And all of this, I think, is some of the work that you're bringing forward and what you're doing, Sam, with the Graticube. Roz, did you want to add before we go back to Sam? And Trina says, listening by looking in their eyes and not moving around while they're talking. Trina, you mean I can't look at my cell phone and I can't text and respond to my emails while I'm talking to you? Is that what you mean? She says no.
No, well, I wanted to chime in on what some stuff Trina's saying, what we're saying. All of this is building a relationship when we're listening, as we're already talking about, but then also it shows, I respect you enough to listen to what you're saying. I don't have to agree with it, but I respect you enough as a person. And also listening, you know, there's a level where you allow a person to come into your space. You know, we have levels, and in the Bible, they said they have the outer court and the inner court. And you, if you're in the outer court, I ain't listening. But if you're in the inner court, if you're a little closer to me, That means that you have an opportunity, that I'm allowing you the opportunity, because I respect you, that I'm going to listen. Now, as we've talked about before, your behavior, you know, may block you from getting closer to me, your behaviors. Then I don't want to listen to your foolery, because I'm not going to let that bad vibe, that noise, that negativity come in. But if you have proved to me through your behaviors, as Mariah has said, that I can trust you in my space, then yes, I'm going to listen to you. But if your behaviors don't, if you can't prove yourself through your behavior that you belong in my space, then I'm not going to listen.
Yeah, that's so good. It's so good where this listening is. And I also think that when we sort of, if we move back to silence, we talked about, we just touched on this for a moment. If we move back to silence, it also allows us to reflect on what's happening within us, right? And it allows us to just sort of be present without all of the other stuff that's happening. And so I think this is a really powerful conversation. GR says, amen, protect your space. And Mom said, listening is also important because your interruption may apply to one person, but not to another. So it's all about that, Mom. It is. It's about how we respect everyone, right? Everyone. And I think we don't recognize that by not being willing to listen to someone, by cutting them off or by not allowing them a chance to speak, it's showing a lack of respect. And so, Sam, when I was preparing for the show, I would love for you to share this story, because I heard you tell this to someone else. You were talking about the fact that you were at one event and being silent, and then someone said to you, "Oh, it was really good to get to know you. Great conversation," right? Can you tell that story?
Yeah, it's a funny thing. I mean, I'd met this person and two others. It was a group of three. It was at Burning Man during that week of silence. And I was showing him around our camp. And we had an art installation. We had all these different things we brought as gifts of experience. And one of them was called the Center of Attention. And the Center of Attention was this art piece in the middle of the desert that would allow people to be heard and just share whatever they wanted to share. And they say, "Hey, I want a back rub." You give them a back rub. That kind of thing. They come into the space. And of course, we had rules of what was okay to ask for and what was sort of, we're not going to offer that. If you ask for it, you don't get it. Kind of like your dojo, right? Yeah. You have these, I wanted to come back to that in a moment about the dojo, because it's such a good metaphor for life. But anyway, the point was that I'd walked around with these people maybe 15, 20 minutes, and I didn't say a word. And I was showing these different things about our camp. And at the end, this guy taps me on the shoulder, kind of pats me on the back and says, "Man, it's so great getting to know you. I really like you. That was great. So good to meet you. Thanks for the conversation."
Didn't say anything.
I didn't say a single word the entire time. And I also wonder, like, was he being ironic? Was he being funny? Or did he really think we had a conversation? And in a way, look, we had a bit of a conversation without words. So that's beautiful. And maybe he did have that sense. Of course, didn't get a chance to ask.
But I think the listening part as well is just not about the sound. It's also, it allows you to look at the body language. So you get a message from the body. So in a way, it's a conversation, even if we don't, you know, label it as such. So the listening actually help you to get the sound and the meaning, but also you calm yourself and you can look at the body language as well, which give you another, you know, another message. So, and help you to really, you know, create the rapport and have some, you know, and have some connection.
We're so kind. I'm just going to say that guy just thought he was having a conversation with himself.
Exactly. So
he didn't hear anything because Sam didn't say anything. So I don't know. But I want to, so it's 9:30. Let's do a commercial break. Mm-hmm. And when we come back, I want Sam to introduce us to his product, his invention, Graticube, because we're talking about these things, about relationships, deepening our connections. And we're going to, I want to learn a little bit more about how this one wonderful product and game can help us with those connections. So we'll do our quick commercial. And on the other side, we'll enter our Mastering the Mat segment, where we will learn a little bit more about how Graticube can help us build these deeper connections.
Are you standing at the helm watching the waves of change crash against your organization? If so, you are not alone. The speed of change can unsettle even the most seasoned leaders, leaving us searching for solid ground. Navigating change isn't just about steering the storm. It's truly about transforming turbulence into momentum. But let's be honest, adapting isn't just difficult, it's downright daunting. With LEADJITSU Executive Coaching, you'll learn to harness the power of martial arts principles for leadership, allowing you to turn change into your ally. Step into the dojo. LEADJITSU, the vision, artistry, and discipline of superb leadership.
Okay, step into the dojo, people. Right now, we're about to master the mat. And if you want to learn more about that, you can visit LEADJITSU.com. But I am really interested in speaking more and learning more. So first of all, Sam, tell us about Graticube. What is it?
All right, so imagine going to the desert, being silent, having amazing experiences for a week, and then wanting to share that beauty of the experience with other people, and saying something like, hey, just go to the desert, take all your stuff with you, pack it in, pack it out for a week, and be silent, and you'll get the magic in this mystery. And nobody's going to say yes to that. It's too much effort. And I'd say, well, hey, find a moment of silence in your day. Maybe it's an hour, maybe it's the whole day. And people say, oh, you know, I'm a busy person. I can't really be silent for a day. That's good for you that you could be silent for. So in other words, it wasn't just about the silence. It was about the experience of hearing people's stories, connecting with people more deeply. And as I began to reflect how to share that, it dawned on me that it could be a game, because really it is a game that we, you know, choose to interact with each other. So what are the elements then that really worked for human connection? What worked, what didn't work? And we talk about the dojo, like I said, I think that's a great metaphor for life, because there's certain rules of engagement, right? You say, here's my dojo. You're welcome in this dojo. Please pay attention to these rules. So if we're gonna spar with each other, it's gonna be playful. We might have some technique, and don't bring a gun. Don't bring a knife, right? There are certain rules of engagement. And if you do, we're gonna ask you to leave the dojo. And mm-hmm. if you decide to play by these rules, we might have a great time and really get to know each other, because we're going to spar, we're going to play a little bit with each other. And that's what this is. So, and we're stepping into the Graticube game. It's about curiosity. It's about listening. It's about story, time, space, and gratitude.
Mm-hmm. Story, time, space, and gratitude. So I will tell you also, the first thing I noticed about the Graticube is how beautiful it is. Like, it's colorful, it's packaged well, the cards are just lovely, and they're colorful, and they're different, and right, you've got the different colors all across the bottom. And so one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to play a little bit. So Roz and Murray and you and I and Sam are going to play a round of this so that people get a sense of it. He and I did a little bit before the show, and it was just very powerful, just in the one that we did, as I was trying to make sure that I understood how this works. And Christopher says, we all tend to forget that the most precious and valuable gifts in life are those that are free. Our ability mm-hmm. to love, our ability to breathe, to be healthy, and to listen to each other's is priceless. Absolutely. So well said, Christopher. Thank you for that. So, Sam, I'm going to let you. Oh, the other thing I wanted to show is these beautiful two die. There are. Mm-hmm. So there are two different die, and they're so beautiful. So walk us through, Sam, if you would facilitate us playing a quick round.
100%. Okay. So I know you have those cards in front of you, Rhonda. So what if you just take three of the red ones and sort of deal them out to yourself? And okay. Two blue ones. The two blue ones are the curiosity cards, and the three red ones are the gratitude cards. Now, all the red ones are the same. They look like this. I'll just hold this up so you can see it. This is a gratitude
card. Oh, okay. So three mm-hmm. gratitude cards. Okay.
So there's your gratitude card. And then what happens in the game, and these are the curiosity. Now, these curiosity questions are all different. Okay. This one says, Would you be willing to give or receive an outside perspective? So the way it works is that there's a story card that basically starts you off with a question. And you have the dice that are time and space that gives you direction and context for that story. So sometimes it's really obvious. You look at the story card and you look at the dice and say, oh, that makes sense. And other times you say, I have no idea what these dice have to do with the card. But it's an invitation to get creative. So start with the question, consider a true moment from your life, share that moment. And then as you do, the people that are playing the game may say, hey, I really appreciate you sharing that. Here's a gratitude card from me. Mm-hmm. Or, hey, you know, I have a question. And since you don't have, Maria and Roz, you don't have these curiosity or gratitude cards, I would just ask you to virtually pass them when you're ready. If you say, hey, I want to hand you a gratitude card. I want to share my gratitude. Or, hey, I've got a question. Even if it's not specifically a question that's on this card, but if you have a question, it's meant to drive the connection a little deeper, take us to a new place. And I think sometimes I've watched people come right to the edge of sharing something and back down because they're not sure if anyone wants to really hear it. So sometimes that extra bit of encouragement can go a long way.
All right, awesome. All right, so what do we do first?
So I would say let's roll the dice and then pull a card.
Okay, I got my dice here. I'm gonna roll the dice. And the dice say never and desire.
All right.
That's okay. Scary.
Desire, never desire. And then what did, let's see, which card are you gonna pull?
All right, so I'm gonna now, so I'm gonna spread my cards out and I don't know, I'm not gonna look, I'm just gonna pick one.
All right.
And it says, describe a time when you felt inspired. Describe a time when you felt inspired. I guess I can't say every day, huh? Oh, I know. So in the work that I was doing, at one point in my life, I met, first of all, I heard the story of an amazing woman who made a difference. And her story was that she came to this country and on vacation, got sick and needed hospitalization and pretty significant illness. And during that hospitalization, she felt that she was not involved in her care. She felt like people were talking around her. They were not involving her in decision-making and did not keep her family informed the way that she wanted. It just wasn't a good experience. And one of the sayings that she said is, do nothing about me without me, right? And then when she left that experience, she said it shouldn't have to be that way. And she formed this organization that I then worked for years later, which was to help change the culture in healthcare so that they were more person-centered. They were, patients were involved, families were involved as a core value of the organization. And then I also met the other trendsetter in the patient care experience, Wendy Leibov, who was also pioneering the patient experience. And these two people were so inspirational and impactful in the way that I think about not only healthcare, my background is healthcare, I'm a registered nurse, but also every other aspect of my life and how I come forward and bring myself forward to care for people.
Beautiful. And then when you look at the dice, how do you feel those dice relate to your story?
So the never is perfect because it's that don't do things to people, do things with them, do things for them, right? And so never do things to people, even telling people what to do and all of that. It's not a partnership. It's not inclusive. And so that is the never that comes forward from that story for me. And then the desire is my deep desire to show up with honoring and respecting people for who they are, wherever they are. I'm not there. I don't need to be there. I don't need to move you. I don't need to convince you. I just have a strong desire to love and accept you for who and where you are.
So I really love that. So I want to give you a gratitude card for what you just shared. And I also have a question And the question is really around, how do you find or learn about that person's need to be cared for? What is it that you found that's really useful as you tap into how to be of service to them?
So one of the main things is less assuming and more asking. And so we assume what we know what people want. We assume we know what they need. We assume we know what's important to them, particularly in the healthcare space, but even beyond. When I'm working with my clients and I'm doing executive coaching, or I'm going into organization and doing training on leadership development, I ask, what feels good to you? What do you want? What do you not want? What words would you like me to avoid? Right? What is your culture? All of those things we ask. And so that's how we find out. Nice. That was fun. All right.
Oh, cool.
So, all right. So so who's going next? Marae, she's she said, Marae is next. Oh, one question from Trina. She said, is the game kid friendly?
Very much so. It is kid friendly. We put on the box that it's really starts for like teenagers at 12, 13, you know, 13 obviously is teenager. But my friend played with his 5-year-old daughter, and later I'll tell you a story if you want to hear it, if we have time for it. But it was surprising to hear her as she connected with some of the words. So some of the words on the dice can be triggering for people, like, you know, you see shame or regrets. Well, that could be triggering. But when you're five, those are new words. Right. And so my friend got to describe what those words mean. And his daughter had an answer from something that happened when she was three. So later we'll talk about that story. But the point is, yes, it is kid friendly. And I think for parents who are willing to have that conversation with their kids and define some of those words and sit and be patient as they come up with a story, something, a true moment from their life, that it can be played by anyone. My grandma, who is 90, she'll be 99 this year, has also played this game. So it's a pretty good range of people who can play this.
Nice. All right. Awesome. And Trina said, awesome. Great way to interact with my 16-year-old daughter. Absolutely. All right. So it's Marae's turn. So how do we do Marae's turn?
Oh, okay. Whoa. That's going to be interesting here.
All right. Well, do you want to roll the dice for her and have her pick a card?
Sorry, Marae. Whatever I roll, I hope it's good.
I hope it's good as well.
Okay, so. Oh, love and now.
All right.
Love and now.
See if you can find a story card for her.
Okay, so Marae, I'm going to let you pick your own story card. I'm just going to kind of move my finger over, right? This is how you said we could do it, Sam. So I'm just going to move my, wait, hold on. I got to get it in the camera. Move my finger over.
Stop.
Okay. All right. And your card says, if I could perform one miracle for someone in my life, it would be.
Okay. So how do we go about it? Do we have to relate it to the love as well?
Well, I think, Sam, explain to her what you share with me.
So it's a good question. Sometimes it's a lot of information all at once. You've got the time, the space, and the card. So what I normally advise people is go with whatever first comes to mind when you hear the card. So what's one, you know, miracle that you'd like to perform? Stay there. And then once you've shared that, come back and see if the – and sometimes it's really obvious. You just go, love, now, boom, it's there. It may not be, and you can come back to it.
So what, one miracle that I really, you know, think that I would love to perform, I've been doing a lot of work, going out regional in some of the country, and particularly the country that I come from in Gabon, and identify some young girl who are really, you know, smart, but because they don't have the support, they don't have the, you know, the not only the financial support, but also the, you know, the coaching, all this talent is really wasted. So that's really, you know, the miracle that I'm really looking for. If I can, you know, save all of them, you know, obviously I've been able to save one or two, but if I could actually save all of them, that would be the miracle for me. And so that's really, you know, something that I dearly want to do.
And so when you think about the dice, love and now, how does that show up for you in that role?
So the, you know, the love is really about how I was myself brought up, because I had a lot of, you know, obviously my parents, but a lot of people actually participated in how I was raised, because and they gave me the love, just the same love that my parents, you know, gave me, because I left Gabon when I was 14, when, you know, lived with a family in France. French people didn't know the culture, but the love came as well. So with this love, I actually, you know, it gave me, you know, another perspective, and also, you know, some real growth and understand what love is in different, you know, in different different culture, different environment, and I think love is very powerful. It doesn't have to always come from people that you know or your parents. If it comes from, you know, different people who showed, it's even more powerful.
Wow. Oh, you get a gratitude card.
For me, I can feel the love in what you do. It's so obvious to me that that's who you are, and you're sharing that and bringing that into the world. So thank you for the good work that you're doing.
Awesome.
You're welcome. Thanks.
Fantastic. All right. We got time for one more. Miss Roz, don't think you're getting away. All right. I got to roll the dice for Roz, right? Look at that. Look at me like I know what's going on.
You're awful familiar with those dice.
Okay. So the one says courage, and then you also get now. So courage and now are in your die. And then you've got to choose your card. Let me open them up here. And I'll start here.
And stop.
Okay. I've got my finger on the card. Okay.
I'm scared.
This one says, what is something you've been holding on to that you want to let go?
I'm putting myself on mute.
I'm gonna be good for the show. You know what though? Things in my past, a part of my past. Okay. I'm holding on to some things, and you know, my girlfriend is here listening. People have spoken some things into my life and said that I couldn't do it or I can't do it, and I haven't done it because of the way that I was handled. So now I'm finally getting the courage. Since last June, I went to an event, and because I'm gonna go ahead and say it, since, you know, Rhonda knows a little bit about my past with my ex-husband. So my ex-husband says something to me, and it's gripped me from doing what I'm supposed to do. And so I never had the courage, because, you know, he always said, oh, you can't do this. You're not this, you're not that. And it was an assignment and a gift in my life. And I didn't know I had it until last June. All of a sudden it just popped up. Mm-hmm. And I did it. And, you know, there's some things that I say, I always say, and I'm gonna talk about this a little bit so some people can connect. I always teach people, say, I don't pray, I don't preach, I don't prophesy the spiritual side of me. And so when we were in this particular atmosphere, the atmosphere, they say, was conducive. It was ripe. It was right there. And I did something that I've never done based on what my husband had said. Based on what? And so that right there has stopped me from doing the assignment spiritually that I have on my life. And from that point forward in the last 12 months, when I did that one thing, has given me the courage And now I'm doing stuff, it's happening so quickly, it's scaring me. It's happening so quickly. But when it happens around people that can guide me and say, okay, it's happening like this because if I have questions, my questions can get answered because I'm in the right place at the right time. Mm-hmm. But I had to, my past has been holding me. And so I have blocked my blessing and I haven't been able to help people because, you know, I said, sometimes it only takes one word between Sunday to Sunday to change somebody's life. His words have had gripped me for over 10 years.
Wow. Okay, so now I'm going to give you a gratitude card.
Thank you.
Well, you're going to get two.
Yes.
Two
gratitude.
Yes. These cards.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Thank you, Rod, for sharing that. So, Sam, you have just done something really incredible here on the show. First of all, I just learned something even more about these two beautiful women that I have been co-hosting with for over 5 years. Right. And so it's a way of just deepening this connection. And is this what you envisioned when you created this game?
This is what I hoped for. That, you know, I'd gone to conferences where there was the guru on stage. And when that guru is gone, you know, you said from Sunday to Sunday, Roz, and sometimes that can come in a lot of different forms. A preacher, it could be a friend, it could be, you know, like I said, a quote unquote guru. I don't know if they would acknowledge themselves as gurus, but they're getting thousands of dollars to present on a stage. And it's like, well, when that person's not available, then what? You know, and there's so much beauty and strength in the friends around us that we have that support. We can tap into this sort of magical space anytime we want, if we choose to ask good questions and choose to listen. So my vision was that anyone could open this box anywhere in the world. If you're human, this is a game for you. We haven't played with aliens yet. Okay, so I don't know. But if you're human, you can play this game. And it doesn't matter what age you are, really, if you have the ability to speak and interact in that way. Like I said, up to even, you know, 5 years old. Maybe there's some four-year-olds that are really pushing the pushing the limit. But this is what I envisioned. It was a way for people to really deeply connect. And what we often hear is that, hey, I've known this person for 10 years, but I just learned these new things. And how is that possible? We chose to ask a new question and chose to listen.
Yeah, I love that. So for those of you out there, I want you to think about these cards, think about the different relationships in your life. Where might this gratitude be helpful in opening up some of those conversations? So GR says, we all have gifts and the world needs us to share those gifts. Absolutely. Trina said, I'm sending gratitude to you, Roz. You go, girl. Thank you all for being out there. Just really, if you could type in the chat, like, what comes up for you? How might you use something like this? I can tell you really quickly, for me, a couple of things that were coming to mind. Often we hear, I do a lot of work in the corporate space, right? Working with leaders and teams and that sort of thing. And often we hear that when someone is newly hired, there's this awkwardness. Mm-hmm. They don't know the team. They're the last person out. There's no great way. You're like, oh, here's your mentor. But I still don't know these other 10 people on the team. It's sort of elongated process of helping someone feel a part of the team. And I thought, what if organizations would use something like a 2 rounds of gratitude when we have a new hire? Because now not only are we getting to know them, but they're getting to know us. Uh-huh. And different questions come up and different cards and that sort of thing. So that's one way that I thought about using this. And I know that there are 1,000 other ways that we could use it as well. So really, really powerful stuff. Thank you for this game and creating it. I think there's a lot of utility here.
You're welcome. It's fun to be here. It's fun to get to know you. And I feel like so often people, when they first interact with each other, are working in that autopilot mode. Where are you from? What do you do? Which is really easy to forget too, because it's not what I want to know about you. I want to know so much more about you. And, you know, knowing that you're from Gabon and that you had this experience going to France, like that I can hold on to that story with so many more questions and curiosity about who you are and the way you serve women. And Roz, what you shared, you know, about your story of opening up and taking that courageous next step to be like, well, I'm not sure about this, but I'm going to do it anyway. It's moving really fast. I'm going to keep doing it. And knowing how great that is for others to see and set that example. And Rhonda, all that you're doing with this show to open up people's hearts and to see the metaphor of life as a dojo, to say, what are those values that we hold and how can we really hold each other accountable in the relationships we have? So it's just a pleasure to be here. And I think that to the degree that we can keep asking each other profound, interested, and authentic questions, it's a gift to all of us, really. We're all going to grow through it.
Yeah, I agree. So GR says, I would love to use this with my accountability partners. We're supporting each other, but this would be great to strengthen our relationships. And you all can go to Amazon and find the Graticube. I went out there. I've been searching. I've been actually sending the link to people that I knew would be tuned in to the show as well. Trina says, these cards will help you open up to your own feelings as well as to others. I really think this game could be an incredible gift to anyone to help invoke mindfulness and appreciation. And this game stimulates your thoughts. Thank you all for contributing that. Let's do our LEADJITSU Leaders Code. We're almost out of time.
Can I share one last thing with you before?
Sure, absolutely.
So we have a really cool partnership with Deepak Chopra. We built a variation of this game with Deepak Chopra called the Game of Abundance. And so there you go. There's the photo. Yep. And so we're working on this game with him to launch this year in the fall with Andrews McMeel Publishing and through Simon & Schuster. And so if there's any interest in exploring the Graticube original game or the Game of Abundance, these are ways that you can engage with your family, yourself, and your people you work with, and even a perfect stranger. How did that person become a friend to begin with? So,
absolutely. Sam, in a bit, just right before we close out, I'm going to ask you to share sort of how people can connect with you as well in case they have questions, et cetera. But let's do our LEADJITSU Leaders Code segment. And this is where we look at our leaders code. So in the work that we do in LEADJITSU, it centers around the leaders code. It's 15 principles that we use to help leaders and organizations guide and navigate the day-to-day challenges they face and help them figure out how to show up in different spaces. So we each choose a leader's code. If you want to grab your own copy of the LEADJITSU Leader's Code, you can go to leaderscode15.com. That's leaderscode15.com. So after the little intro here, we'll each share which leader's code resonates with us. All right, Sam, I'm actually going to start with you this time. Which leader's code resonates with you?
Well, I don't think you're going to find this surprising, but I would say empathetic connection. Definitely empathetic connection. I think when we choose to tune in, Maria, what you were saying about it's not just what someone's saying, but they, with their words, but maybe their body language. That's a way to be tuned in empathetically and seek that connection together. So even just being silent together is a way of honoring that person and being in that empathetic moment with them. So I really like that. I think these principles are fantastic. And that's the one that really stands out to me the best.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that, Sam. Marae, which code for you?
So for me today is really the first one, the Dojo respect, because we talked a lot about giving space to others and respecting them in our relationship, and also being able to to show the authentic us to them. So it really resonates with me today, the Dojo respect, which is understanding the paramount of importance of showing reverence and consideration for others and oneself. So respecting others, but also respecting self. And that's really strong for me today.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Roz?
I was looking at number four, the warrior's courage. And because you have to have a courage when you're, talking about this, these challenges, should I open up? Should not open up? And as a leader or anybody, it's just like to me for today, it was a challenge. I had to hold back tears because I'm like, this has really been gripping me for 10 years. It's really, so it was, It was a good thing. It was a good thing because I allow someone else to have control over me. And today I think I was able to break it.
Mm-hmm.
I was able to finally break it.
Thank you, Roz. Thank you. No, you never, ever on this show have to apologize for being who you are and being vulnerable, because it's a part of what we do, and it's part of why we're here. For me, Sensei's humility really shows up for me today. And it says, in Sensei's humility, Leadjitsu leaders embody perpetual learning and openness to feedback. It's that openness that really captures me today. Being willing to create space and to hear and to share with others in that very authentic and open way. So that's what shows up for me. And thank you all for participating in this LEADJITSU Leaders Code segment. I'm gonna just do a quick closeout segment here. We'll be back in just a second. All right, you can access your own LEADJITSU Leaders Code, talk to your teams, work on yourself with it, leaderscode15.com. So we're wrapping up. Thank you so much. What an incredible show. What an incredible show. I am loving everything about this. And Sam, I want to just give you an opportunity to share any final words with us and also share with us how people can reach out and connect with you.
Well, first of all, thank you. This has been really wonderful to drop in with you and get to know you at this level. And, you know, the game doesn't mean anything without the invitation and the willingness to show up this way. So otherwise, it's just cards and dice. But otherwise, you know, nothing. And here it's everything. So thank you for dropping in from, you know, being in your hearts. And I feel very grateful to be in this moment with you. For us, it's connect. We are a nonprofit. Our mission is to connect people throughout their communities, wherever they are in the world. And so it really, you know, with the right values, it doesn't then matter what kind of company it is. If it has good values, then we want to support that. If it's a community that needs help, we want to support that facilitation. So we facilitate groups playing this game. And one way it seems easy, open the box, play the game. But some people want that facilitation, especially companies and at conferences and retreats. We just did this in Hawaii with a group of 50, another group in New York, a group of 100. And so it's my pleasure and delight to bring people together and facilitate. And for anyone who wants to connect, you can go to graticube.game. So it's not .game.com, it's just graticube.game. And you can also email me, sam@graticube.game, and would love to connect with you.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here. Everyone, thank you for hanging out with us. Thank you for playing along. We learned a lot today. We had some fun. We shared some moments. And so that's what we do. So thank you, Roz and Murray, as always. I hope y'all have fun. You know, we'll be chatting in the back in just a second. But everyone, stay tuned and join us next week for another episode where we'll have another fantastic conversation. Next week on the show, we're going to be talking about who's responsible for your culture of inclusion and your culture of belonging. Who owns the responsibility for that? So we're looking forward to next week's show as we dive into that. See you back here next week, same time, same station, for another episode of LEADJITSU Rise in the Dojo. Until then, everyone, see you next week.